just got in today. And I always forget how beautiful Seattle is. Just the mountains and the water. It's gorgeous. It's really striking. And it's hard to believe that it's been 16 years since I was here locking down streets and getting gassed and running away through past police cars that had been spray painted with anarchy symbols. I don't know if any of you remember the WTO protests, but it's a long time ago. A lot's happened. One of the things was a war that I served in for reasons that I'm not going to go into now. And when I got back from the war and when I got out of the Army, I went back to school and I wasn't thinking a lot about climate change. I wasn't thinking a lot about global warming. I had, other things on my plate. It was sort of this, distant, vague, ominous threat that I thought would, we'd have to deal with someday, would affect us, maybe our kids. But then a couple years ago, I got the chance to go to a seminar on the Anthropocene at Cornell. And in preparing for that seminar, I spent time, I did my research. I caught up on the situation with climate change, and I realized that we're screwed. Looking at documents like the IPCC reports and reports from the World Bank and things that the U.S. Department of Defense was releasing, like major mainstream organizations saying that if we kept on the path that we're on now, business as usual, we face catastrophic climate change that threatens to undermine the very basis of civilization as we know it. And I had a kind of existential crisis thinking about this, coming to terms with it. I was in the Army and went back to school and spent all this time working on a graduate degree. And the world's ending. I didn't know what to do. And so I did what I often do is I wrote my way through it, thinking about it. And I went back to some of the things I'd learned in Iraq, some of the things I'd learned before about coming to terms with mortality, coming to terms with the end of things, right? So when I was a soldier in Iraq, when I was driving a Humvee around Baghdad, I was, there were IEDs, snipers, I was there 2003 to 2004. There was a lot going on. And at first, I was terrified, and I didn't know how to handle it. In fact, I got so worked up about watching for IEDs on the road. I was often in the lead Humvee, so I felt like the responsibility was on me if anything happened. That it started to keep me from being able to do my job. I was just so nervous, freaked out. And how I got through that was coming to this 17th century samurai manual by Yamamoto Tsunetomo, the Hagakure, the Book of the Samurai, right? And it's basically like, Zen Buddhism for samurai. And what he advocates in that, one thing he says in there is that, a samurai should meditate on death every day. And I took that to heart, and I spent every morning before we went out on patrol thinking about all the different ways I could die, and imagining it, working through it, and owning it, really coming to terms with it. And doing that practice, having that meditative practice, that reflective practice, opened up a space and a kind of liberation for me to be able to do my job as a, imperial occupier. Still had to do my job to get out of there. And that wisdom came back to me through Buddhism, through Spinoza, through all kinds of Western philosophy, through a long tradition of philosophy going back to Plato that argues that philosophy itself is learning how to die. And so that's how I developed this idea and came to the essay that then became this book, Learning to Die in the Anthropocene. Coming to terms with climate change and this idea of the Anthropocene, which you may or may not know, it's this idea that some geologists are floating, that we've entered a new geological epoch in the Earth's history, one characterized by the advent of human beings as a geological force, right? So we're affecting the very geology of the Earth and will for hundreds of thousands of years. That's the idea of the Anthropocene. So I put these two things together and thought about it. And as a way of dealing with the fact that it doesn't seem like there's any good way out with climate change. You know, we had our first, it was almost 30 years ago. It was 1988 when James Hansen, former NASA scientist, stood before the U.S. Congress and told them that the science was 99% certain that the Earth was warming, it was anthropogenic, and that it was a dire threat. And nothing has changed since then. In fact, our carbon emissions have only increased year after year, year after year. So I'm going to read some from this book and deal with this question, and then we'll have a conversation. When a honeybee colony needs to find a new home, it sends out wave after wave of scouts to search for a new hive site. When the scouts return, they dance for the other bees. Each scout's dance communicates a possible location for the colony's future. As new waves of scouts go out and return, they align themselves with one dance or another, depending on what they found. Soon, in a vast, rollicking caucus, masses of bees are all dancing to a variety of distinct rhythms, each dance offering a different vision of tomorrow. One dance may be for a nearby oak, another for a distant elm. One dance offers an ambitious journey, another is more conservative. Over time, a single dance grows more and more popular until a majority of bees are doing it. The swarm has made its decision and takes flight. Politics, whether for bees or for humans, is the energetic distribution of bodies in systems. This is where the idea of the vote, the town hall meeting, and the public debate get their power. Humans come together to resonate on one frequency or another. Arrangements of bodies and systems don't arise from ideal notions of how governance should work, but emerge rather out of the vibrating bodies themselves, the systems they inhabit, and the interactions between the two. The key is energy, energy production, and social energetics. Just as a beehive is structured around the production of honey, so are human societies structured around labor, horses, wheat, coal, and oil. How bodies harvest, produce, organize, and distribute energy determines how power flows, shaping the political arrangements of a given system, a given collective organism, behind whatever ideologies the ruling classes may use to manufacture consent, obscure the mechanisms of control, or convince themselves of their infallible omniscience. Humanity has undergone three major revolutions in the political structures of energy production in the past 200,000 years: the agricultural revolution, the industrial revolution, and the great acceleration, the transition from coal to mixed fossil fuels. The agricultural revolution shifted human social organization from the pack to the herd, from nomadic life to sedentary life, inaugurating politics as we understand it, meaning the life of the polis, the city, urban existence, civilization. With the advent of the farm and the city, humans no longer followed migrating energy stocks, tracking the sweeping herds of ungulates that were once a primary source of food, but cultivated stocks in place: sheep, wheat, einkorn, states. The distribution of bodies in fields, pastures, canals, and cities gave rise to new forms of social energetics that superseded tribes and tribal confederations. In ancient Uruk, despotism and empire emerged as political technologies to deal with the intricate demands of flood-based irrigation. Single farmers or clans couldn't manage the intensive mass labor required to dredge canals and harvest grain at critical moments in the growing season. So centralized absolutist systems and ideologies were invented to control production. Elsewhere, as agricultural technology spread to fertile areas less dependent on annual floods and complex irrigation, less centralized political technologies were developed, such as feudalism. Around 12,000 years after the invention of agriculture, the Industrial Revolution shifted human social organization from photosynthetic stocks to fossilized carbon stocks. This freed us from our dependence on plant and animal energy and opened up incredible new flows of power. While the organization of bodies around coal pits, railroads, and teeming conurbations in the 19th and early 20th centuries gave rise to mass social democracy, state nationalism, and industrial capitalism. As Timothy Mitchell argues in his book Carbon Democracy, the ability of tenacious, highly organized coal miners to interrupt energy flows gave them significant leverage in what had been previously essentially feudal and absolutist systems. Rulers were forced to listen to workers, because coal miners at the forefront of the labor movement could interrupt the operations of an entire country. Through labor unions, general strikes, and sabotage sustained by the ability of coal miners, railroad workers, teamsters, and longshoremen to paralyze national economies, working people in the industrial West acquired a power that would have seemed impossible before the late 19th century. Timothy Mitchell writes, "Workers were gradually connected together, not so much by the weak ties of a class culture, collective ideology, or political organization, but by the increasing and highly concentrated quantities of carbon energy they mined, loaded, carried, stoked, and put to work. The coordinated acts of interrupting, slowing down, or diverting its movement created a decisive political machinery, a new form of collective capability built out of coal mines, railways, power stations, and their operators." That collective capability waned with the great acceleration in the middle of the 20th century, as industrial society shifted from reliance on coal to a mixed use of coal, oil, and natural gas. Unlike a coal-based economy, which relies on raw labor in numbers, oil and gas production requires relatively few workers. Labor retained vestigial power for decades, but the realignment of energy flows from solid coal to liquid petroleum and natural gas severely weakened the effect of political power that coal miners and their allies could leverage, substantially undermining mass social democracy as a technology of power. Liquid carbon stocks come to us through decentralized networks managed by small crews of highly trained technicians and owned by a handful of corporations, nations, and individuals. Coal must be physically dug out of the ground and transported by fixed rail lines to distribution centers, but oil and gas are mechanically pumped by pipeline from remote wells to ports, where the liquids are loaded onto tankers that can be sent practically anywhere and rerouted in transit with ease. As Mitchell explains, whereas the movement of coal tended to follow dendritic networks with branches at each end but a single main channel, creating potential choke points at several junctures, oil flowed along networks that often had the properties of a grid, like an electricity network, where there's more than one possible path, and the flow of energy can switch to avoid blockages or overcome breakdowns. Populist movements that used to be able to organize around the centralized flows of coal civilization are all but powerless when it comes to interrupting the much more flexible flows of oil and gas, isolated high-profile cases like the Keystone XL pipeline notwithstanding. Growing from and resonating with the flows of material power that sustain them, our political arrangements today are collective organisms of consuming bodies in decentralized systems managed by technicians for the profit of the few. At the top, there's an oligarchy of owners who control the lion's share of world energy production. They rule through a technocratic administrative class of operators and politicians and run mass media elections to jockey for control amongst themselves and manufacture ritual consent. Most people participate, if at all, as consumers. watching the election games and voting for one of the handful of officially sanctioned candidates. The few activists who try to effect reform are hobbled by systemic constraints. Protest politics and web-based outrage may send signals to the ruling elites, but these strategies exert no effective pressure. No matter how many people take to the streets in massive marches or in targeted direct actions, they cannot put their hands on the flows of power because they don't help produce it. They only consume. Take the People's Climate March. On a mild, overcast Sunday morning in September 2014, more than 300,000 people gathered along the west side of Central Park in New York City for what was billed the largest climate march in history. The march was being held in advance of the United Nations Climate Summit, organized by Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, where more than 100 heads of state planned to make public commitments to investing in renewable energy, supporting green development in the global south, developing legally binding regulations on carbon, and working together to help the world's most threatened countries adapt to climate-related risk. I was there as a freelance journalist to talk to marchers and get a feel for the event, but I was also there as one of the people whose march it supposedly was, a concerned global citizen, a worried and guilty American. I'd marched in New York before, against the war in Iraq, for Veterans Day, for Gay Pride, Halloween, and West Indian Day, and this march, like those, was a carefully managed event. Indeed, the People's Climate March was a logistical behemoth involving more than 1,500 organizations, each with its own interests and concerns. In order to keep those various organizations united, the march's leading groups, Avaz and 350.org, decided to forego message unity, concrete demands, or a clear target. The main message of the march was going to be the march itself. Yet the message the march was supposed to embody was never clear. If the intent was to raise awareness, we'd be right to ask what a march is supposed to do that a preponderance of scientific data, decades of research, almost daily articles in major media outlets worldwide, and 19 United Nations conferences on the issue since the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change first met in Berlin in 1995 could not. If the plan was to convince conservative and mainstream Americans to pay attention to climate change, it's hard to see how a bunch of environmentalists marching through a city most Americans consider a bastion of rich liberals might be expected to accomplish that. If the intent was to demonstrate the political power that the umbrella organizations could motivate in terms of voters, we should ask which voters, where they're from, how they usually vote, and how many there were. None of that information was collected, so one's left to wonder exactly what kind of pressure this march was supposed to put on the American political process, or, for that matter, any political process. The march was tightly constrained by police barriers, directed through low traffic streets far from the United Nations, far from the meeting it was supposed to influence, and dumped out in the empty blocks along the Hudson River west of Midtown. With no closing rally to unify the protesters, the march ended with an incoherent whimper, as thousands of atomized individuals scattered back to their subways, cars, and digitally wired but politically disconnected lives. In truth, the People's Climate March was little more than an orgy of democratic emotion, an activist-themed street fair, a real-world analog to Twitter hashtag campaigns, something that gives you a nice feeling, says you belong to a certain group, and is completely divorced from actual legislation and governance. Given the march's tremendous built-in weaknesses, the best we might have hoped for is that it accomplished nothing. What's more likely, though, is that it siphoned off organizing energy that could have been more useful elsewhere, made a public display of climate activism's political impotence, and soothed hundreds of thousands of people with a false sense of hope. At the UN Climate Summit 2 days after the march, attendees didn't even get that spurious elixir. The only cure on offer there was bureaucratic anesthetic. I made it to the upper balcony of the General Assembly Hall just in time to catch the last few minutes of Leonardo DiCaprio's mellifluous opening speech, and sat through much of the day with other journalists and observers in the nosebleed seats watching the statesman dull pageant take place far below. While a range of development and finance schemes were presented as solutions, what the summit came down to was a bleak ritual of stalemate, as if the world's leaders had been cast in a business class version of Samuel Beckett's Endgame. One after another, they stood at the podium mouthing vacuities, boldly committing to toothless, voluntary emission reductions that are too little, too late. The heads of Russia, Australia, Germany, India, and China didn't even bother showing up. Barack Obama delivered a stirring oration about how everyone needs to work together, chiding China while glorifying America's negligible emissions cuts, ignoring the roles that American coal and American consumption play in stoking China's growth. The president of Tanzania, Jakaya Kikwete, complained about how little African countries had contributed to the problem and how much they stand to suffer, speaking poignantly about Mount Kilimanjaro's disappearing glaciers. Baron Waka, president of Nauru and chair of the Alliance of Small Island States, argued passionately for more investment to help existentially threatened nations like his own adapt. Chinese Vice Premier Zhang Gaoli addressed the United Nations with a stiff and defensive speech in which he promised that China would peak its carbon emissions as soon as possible and reduce its per capita emissions whenever it got around to it. A position only notionally mitigated by the subsequent U.S.-China climate agreement. Between marching in the protest on Sunday and going to the U.N. summit on Tuesday, I rushed up and down Manhattan all day Monday, shuttling between two other events that seemed to promise more concrete results. Down at the island's narrow southern tip, a few hundred hardcore activists put their bodies on the line to flood Wall Street. While at the Harvard Club in Midtown, a group of government administrators, corporate representatives, bankers, and economists met to work out a global pricing mechanism at the International Emissions Trading Association. At Flood Wall Street, which began with a marching band dancing and speeches from Naomi Klein, Chris Hedges, Mamadou Goïta, Elisa Estronioli, and others, the message, mission, and enemy were all clearly identified. The protesters were marching to Wall Street in a nonviolent direct action against what they saw as the real problem behind climate change, capitalism. Signs named the usual suspects, the villainous Koch brothers, ExxonMobil, and Shell. The protest parade of anarchists, environmentalists, and Occupy veterans blocked traffic around Arturo de Mudica's Charging Bull for a few hours, then made their way to the intersection of Broadway and Wall Street. The New York City Police Department maintained overt control of the situation the entire time, surrounding the marchers with a loose cordon from beginning to end. Helicopters buzzed low overhead while a nattily dressed community liaison detective observed the situation up close. Wall Street itself had been blocked off by barriers and horse-mounted police long before the protest began. The marchers never stood a chance of getting through. In terms of its own expressed goal, the action was a failure before it even began. The protesters didn't give up, though. They held the intersection of Broadway and Wall under the steeple of Trinity Church all afternoon long. Once the sun set, the cops closed in, ordering the protesters to disperse. 104 stalwart souls refused to leave and were arrested, including one sweaty activist in a polar bear suit. While the rabble faced off against the fuzz downtown, power industry elites at the Harvard Club discussed how to profitably trade waste. On the International Emissions Trading Association's first panel, government representatives talked about how carbon pricing schemes were working to reduce carbon emissions in California and Europe, and Tang Ji, the vice mayor of Shenzhen, China, spoke about his country's carbon market and Shenzhen's long-term development plans. In contrast to Zhang Gaoli's stiff, almost hostile speech at the United Nations the next day, Tang Ji was self-deprecating, effusive, and genial. But while the body language and tone of Tang Ji's speech was as obsequious as Zhang Gaoli's was belligerent, the semantic content of the two speeches was the same. China means to be rich, and it's not going to slow down for anyone. Following Tang Ji, Harvard economist Robert Stavins delivered a brief executive summary of the carbon pricing study he'd headed, facilitating linkage of heterogeneous regional, national, and subnational climate policies through a future international agreement. According to Stavins, the best result we could expect from the Paris 2015 United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change meeting this November would be a carbon market deal loosely linking various national, regional, local, and corporate systems of carbon pricing and regulation through a unified monitoring system in which nations would, quote, specify their own targets, actions, policies, or some combination of these to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. This sounded ominously vague. I was soon to understand how empty it really was. The last panel featured spokespeople from Statoil, the Environmental Defense Fund, GDF Suez, and Barclays, all offering more or less hopeful perspectives on the wondrous possibilities of carbon trading. But the key message seemed to be the one delivered by David Hone, chief climate change advisor for Shell, who translated Stavins' bureaucraties into the much franker point that the only kind of carbon pricing agreement that had any chance of being signed in Paris would have to be totally non-binding, which means totally unenforceable. As with the protesters downtown, everyone in the room seemed to agree that somebody needed to do something about climate change, and soon. But unlike the protesters at Flood Wall Street, who saw capitalism as the underlying problem, the folks at the Harvard Club saw capitalism as the only possible framework for solutions. For the IETA, international legal agreements, corporate management, and market-based mechanisms were the only functional machinery for forging a global response to a global crisis. If this machinery was limited, slow, and troublesome, that didn't mean that it was part of the problem. Rather, such limitations were taken as the conditions through which concerned people had to work. Admitting failure wasn't an option. Even if the grandstanding at the United Nations and technocratic equivocations at the IETA offered direct evidence for what the thinker Thomas, the economist Thomas Schelling argues, that the likelihood of the planet's almost 200 nations drafting a binding emissions reduction plan is practically non-existent. The only good odds are for more of the same, business as usual, which means at best a voluntary and therefore functionally meaningless agreement. Meanwhile, on the very same day that the People's Climate March kicked off, the Global Carbon Project released a new report showing that global greenhouse gas emissions rose 2.3% in 2013, with China's emissions growing 4.2%, India's growing 5.1%, and America's growing 2.9%. So much for Obama's oratory. This seems to be the situation we're stuck in. On the left and on the right, among diplomats, energy company executives, investors, scientists, anarchists, clergy, and activists, serious people are worried about global warming and feel the urgent need to do something about it. Across the spectrum, though, nobody seems to have the tools, clout, or conceptual framework we need to fix it, or even to come up with a good plan to protect ourselves from the greatest dangers. There's no reset button for civilization, and no viable plan for transforming global infrastructure, agriculture, and energy networks in the next 10 to 20 years. And while smart, dedicated, and thoughtful people fumble with political machinery that doesn't work, such as carbon pricing markets, protests, and the United Nations, all of us in the global north go on about our business, driving, flying, leaving lights on, running heaters and air conditioners, eating meat, charging our devices, living unsustainable lives predicated on easy consumption. In a perverse irony, one of the main things that connected the disparate parties at the United Nations, Flood Wall Street, the IETA, and the People's Climate March was a system of cultural technology that's silently burning up masses of carbon while shunting activist outrage into impotent feedback loops. The most common sight at all the events that week was people on their iPhones and Androids, checking email, tweeting, taking pictures. The global information and communications ecosystem that they were plugged into is now estimated to use about 10% of the world's electricity. That ecosystem relies heavily on coal. Every time you check your email, you're heating up the planet. We do it every day. We can't stop. We won't stop. The problem with the People's Climate March wasn't really that it lacked a goal, or that it was distracting, superficial, and vacuous. The problem with the United Nations isn't that the politicians are ignorant, hidebound, self-interested, or corrupt. The problem with our response to climate change isn't a problem with passing the right laws or finding the right price for carbon or changing people's minds or raising awareness. Everybody already knows. The problem is that the problem's too big. The problem is that different people want different things. The problem is that nobody has real answers. The problem is that the problem's us. Now, you've heard the call. We have to do something. We need to fight. We need to identify an enemy and go after them. Some respond, march and chant. Some look away, deny what's happening, and search out escape routes into imaginary tomorrows. A life off the grid, space colonies, immortality in paradise, explicit denial, consumer satiety in a wireless robot staff 3D printed techno-utopia. Meanwhile, the rich take shelter in their fortresses, trusting to their air conditioning, private schools, and well-paid guards. Fight. Flight. Flight. Fight. The threat of death activates our deepest animal drives. The aggression and fear that arise in response to perceived threats are some of the most intense emotions we ever experience. For human society to function at all, these instinctive reactions have to be carefully managed and channeled. Outbreaks of panic and hate are dangerous, but lower levels of aggression and fear help keep a population controllable and productive. Restrained aggression keeps people suspicious of collective action and working hard to overcome their fellows, while constant generalized anxiety keep people servile, unwilling to take risks, and yearning for comfort from whatever quarter, whether the dulling sameness of herd thought or the dumb security of consumer goods. Fear comes to us every day. Fear comes to us every day in our encounters with an increasingly militarized police and our humiliating interactions and metal detectors and body scan machines. Fear comes to us in the absence of job security, in our want of appeal when confronted by institutionalized inequality, and in our mistrust of corrupt institutions. Fear comes to us in widespread surveillance, in the form of a homeless woman or a hospitalized friend without adequate financial support, and in the constant nagging worry that we're not working hard enough, not happy enough, never going to make it. Fear comes to us in weather porn, unpredictable shifts in formerly stable climate dynamics, and massive storms. More than in any other way, fear comes to us in images and messages, as social media vibrations, products of cultural technologies that we've interpolated into our lives. Going about our daily business, we receive constant messages of apprehension and danger, ubiquitous warnings, insistent needling jabs to the deep lizard brain. Somebody died. Something blew up. Something might blow up. Somebody attacked somebody. Somebody killed somebody. Guns, crime, immigrants, terrorists, Arabs, Mexicans, white supremacists, killer cops, demonic thugs, rape, murder, global warming, Ebola, ISIS, death, death, death. Sociologist Tom Pyszczynski writes, people will do almost anything to avoid being afraid. When, despite the best efforts, fear and anxiety do break through, people go to incredible lengths to shut them down. Sometimes when these vibrations shake us, we discharge them by passing them on, retweeting the story, reposting the video, hoping that others will validate our reaction, thus assuaging our fear by assuring ourselves that collective action has been alerted to the threat. Other times, we react with aversion, working to dampen the vibrations by searching out positive reinforcements, pleasurable images and videos, something funny, something, anything to ease the fear. We buy something, we eat food, we pop a pill, we make love. And either passing on the vibration or reacting against it, we let the fear short-circuit our own autonomous desires, diverting us from our goals and loading ever more emotional static into our daily cognitive processing. We become increasingly distracted from our ambitions and increasingly susceptible to such distraction. And whether we retransmit or react, we reinforce channels of thought, perception, behavior, and emotion that, over time, come to shape our habits and our personality. As we train ourselves to resonate fear and aggression, we reinforce patterns of thought and feeling that shape a society that breeds the same. Fight or flight is compelling because it serves essential evolutionary purposes. It increases alertness and adrenaline flow, and generally works to keep the human animal alive. As we proceed into the Anthropocene, though, capitalism's cultural machinery for balancing fear and aggression against desire and pleasure is grinding and sputtering sparks. what cultural theorist Lauren Berlant has identified as the cruel optimism of a system sustained by hopes that can never be fulfilled mixes dangerously with an atmosphere of beleaguered anxiety, increasing frustration with working class and middle class economic stagnation, and a pervasive sadistic voyeurism that grows by what it feeds on. While America's fraying social infrastructure holds together, our fear and aggression can be channeled into labor, consumption, and economic competition, with professional sports, hyperviolent television, and occasional protests to let off steam. Once the social fabric begins to tear, though, we risk unleashing not only rioting, rebellion, and civil war, but homicidal politics, the likes of which should make our blood run cold. Consider, Iraq today is being torn apart between a corrupt petrocracy, a breakaway Kurdish enclave, and a self-declared Islamic fundamentalist caliphate, while a civil war in neighboring Syria spills across its borders. These conflicts have likely been caused in part and exacerbated by the worst drought the Middle East has seen in modern history. Since 2006, Syria has been suffering crippling water shortages that have, in some areas, caused 75% crop failure and wiped out 85% of livestock, left more than 800,000 Syrians without a livelihood, and sent hundreds of thousands of impoverished young men streaming into Syria's cities, now into Europe. This drought is part of long-term warming and drying trends that are transforming the Middle East. Not just water, but oil, too, is elemental to these conflicts. Iraq sits in the fifth largest proven oil reserves in the world. Meanwhile, the Islamic State has only been able to survive because it has taken control of most of Syria's oil and gas production. We tend to think of climate change and violent religious fundamentalism as isolated phenomena. But as retired Navy Rear Admiral David Titley argues, you can draw a very credible climate connection to this disaster we call ISIS right now. Meanwhile, thousands of miles to the north, Russian-backed separatists are fighting fascist paramilitary forces defending the elected government of Ukraine, which is also suffering drought. Russia's role as an oil and gas exporter in the region and the natural gas pipelines running through Ukraine from Russia to Europe cannot but be key issues in the conflict. Elsewhere, droughts in 2014 sent refugees from Guatemala and Honduras north to the U.S. border, devastated crops in California and Australia, and threatened millions of lives in Eritrea, Somalia, Ethiopia, Sudan, Uganda, Afghanistan, India, Morocco, Pakistan, and parts of China. Across the world, massive protests and riots have swept Bosnia and Herzegovina, Venezuela, Brazil, Turkey, Egypt, and Thailand, while conflicts rage on in Colombia, Libya, the Central African Republic, Sudan, Nigeria, Yemen, and India. And while the world burns, the United States is playing chicken with Russia over control of Eastern Europe and the melting Arctic, and now Syria, and with China over control of Southeast Asia and the South China Sea, threatening global war on a scale not seen in 70 years. This is our present and future. Droughts and hurricanes, refugees and border guards, war for oil, water, gas, and food. We experience this world of strife today in one of two modes. Either it's our environment, and we're in it, or it comes to us as images, social excitation, retransmitted fear. People are fighting and dying in ruined cities all over the planet. Neighbors are killing each other. Old women are bleeding to death in bombed rubble, and children are being murdered, probably as we sit here right now. To live in that world is horrific. Constant danger strains every nerve. The only things that matter there are survival, killing the enemy, reputation, and having a safe place to sleep. The experience of being human narrows to a cutting edge. I remember living in that world many years ago in occupied Baghdad. Today that world seems impossibly distant. Yet every day it presses in on me in a never-ending stream of words, images, appeals, and reports. I see videos. I read stories. I see pictures of this or that suffering or injustice, and I'm moved. To act, perhaps, but more accurately, to emote. To react, to feel, to perform. We don't usually ask where these feelings come from or who they serve. But we all know that the cultural technologies transmitting these affective vibrations are not neutral. News outlets shape information to fit their owners' prejudices, while Facebook, Twitter, and Google shape our perceptions through hidden algorithms. The specialization and demographic targeting of contemporary media tend to narrow the channels of perception to the point that we receive only those images and vibrations which already harmonize with our own prejudices, our own pre-existing desires, thus intensifying our particular emotional reactions along an increasingly limited band, impelling us to discharge our emotions within the same field of ready listeners, for which we are rewarded with likes and favorites. Our consciousness is shaped daily through feedback systems where some post or headline provokes a feeling, and we discharge that feeling by provoking it in others. Social media like Facebook crowdsource catharsis, creating self-contained wave pools of aggression and fear, pity and terror, stagnant flows that go nowhere and do nothing. Pictures of children killed by bombs or police, or pictures of the devastation left in the wake of a tropical storm may move me to sadness and horror. Retransmitting such images will pass along that sadness and horror. My act of transmission marks me as someone who has feelings about these things and who condemns them. I can rationalize my retransmission by saying that I'm raising awareness or trying to influence public policy. I want my fellow citizens to be as horrified as I am, so they'll think like I do, or so they'll vote for a representative who works to prevent such horrors from happening. Or maybe so that if enough of us all think the same way and feel the same way, the organs and institutions of power will be forced to hear us and align themselves along our vibrations, the way a honeybee colony will pick a site for a new hive through the dance of its advance guard scouts. These are perfectly reasonable human assumptions, because that's how physical human collectives function. Anyone who's been in a crowd, a basketball team, a nightclub, a choir, or a protest knows how bodies resonate together. But politics is the energetic distribution of bodies and systems. And we live in a system of carbon-fueled capitalism that we shouldn't expect to work in physical human ways, especially when it comes to responding to the threat of global warming. First, our political and social media technologies are not neutral, but have been developed to serve particular interests. Most notably targeted advertising, concentration of wealth, and ideological control. And the vibrations that seem to resonate most strongly along these channels are envy, adulation, outrage, fear, hatred, and mindless pleasure. Second, the more we pass on or react to social vibrations, the less we practice autonomous reflection or independent critical thought. With every protest chant, retweet, and Facebook post, we become stronger resonators and weaker thinkers. Third, however intense our social vibrations grow, they remain locked within machinery that offers no political leverage. They don't translate into political action because they don't connect to the flows of power. Finally, while the typical collective human response to threat is to identify an enemy, pick sides, and mobilize to fight, global warming offers no apprehensible foe. That hasn't stopped people from trying to find one, of course. The Flood Wall Street protesters say the enemy is American capitalism. Tanzania's Jakaya Kikwete and Nauru's Baron Waka say the problem is United States and Great Britain. Shell Oil and the Environmental Defense Fund seem to think that it's intractable UN bureaucracy that's holding us back. Barack Obama has implied that it's China. Tea Party Republicans would blame Barack Obama, I'm sure, if they admitted that global warming was actually happening, caused by human activity. Meanwhile, NPR-listening liberals want to believe that the Tea Party Republicans are responsible so that they can frame the problem as one amenable to solution by moral education and enlightened consumerism, as if it were all a matter of convincing people to eat more kale and drive electric cars. One climate activist has argued that just 90 companies are responsible for almost two-thirds of all historical greenhouse gas emissions, which conveniently absolves billions of automobile drivers, airline passengers, meat eaters, and cell phone users of responsibility. The enemy isn't out there somewhere. The enemy is ourselves, not as individuals, but as a collective, a system, a hive. How do we stop ourselves from fulfilling our fates as suicidally productive drones in a carbon-addicted hive? destroying ourselves in some kind of psychopathic colony collapse disorder? How do we interrupt the perpetual circuits of fear, aggression, crisis, and reaction that continually prod us to ever more intense levels of manic despair? One way we might begin to answer these questions is by considering the problem of global warming in terms of Peter Sloterdijk's, the German philosopher Peter Sloterdijk's idea of the philosopher as an interrupter. We live constantly in collective fields of excitation, he writes. This cannot be changed so long as we are social beings. The input of stress inevitably enters me. Thoughts are not free. Each of us can divine them. They come from the newspaper and wind up returning to the newspaper. My sovereignty, if it exists, can only appear by my letting the integrated impulsion die in me, or, should this fail, by my retransmitting it in a totally metamorphosed, verified, filtered, or recoded form. It serves nothing to contest it. I am free only to the extent that I interrupt escalations and that I am able to immunize myself against infections of opinion. Precisely this continues to be the philosopher's mission in society, if I may express myself in such pathetic terms, he writes. His mission is to show that a subject can be an interrupter, not merely a channel that allows thematic epidemics and waves of excitation to flow through it. The classics express this with the term pondering. With this concept, ethics and energetics enter into contact. As a bearer of a philosophical function, I have neither the right nor the desire to be either a conductor in a stress semantic chain or the automaton of an ethical imperative. Sloterdijk compares the conception of political function as collective vibration to a philosophical function of interruption. As opposed to disruption, which shocks a system and breaks holes into pieces, interruption suspends continuous processes. It's not smashing, but sitting with. Not blockage, but reflection. Sloterdijk sees the role of the philosopher in the human swarm as that of an aberrant anti-drone, slow dancing to its own rhythm. Neither attuned to the collective beat, nor operating mechanically, dogmatically, deontologically, but continually self-immunizing against the waves of social energy we live in and amongst by perpetually interrupting its own connection to collective life. So long as one allows oneself to be a conductor in a stress semantic chain, one is strengthening channels of retransmission regardless of content, thickening the reflexive connective tissues of mass society, making all of us all the more susceptible to such viral phenomena as nationalism, scapegoating, panic, and war fever. Interrupting the flows of social production is anarchic and counterproductive, like all good philosophy. If it works, it helps us stop and see our world in new ways. If it fails, as it often and maybe even usually does, the interrupter is integrated, driven mad, ignored, or destroyed. What Sloterdijk helps us see, though, is that responding autonomously to social excitation means not reacting to it, not passing it on, but interrupting it, then either letting the excitation die or transforming it completely. Responding freely to constant images of fear and violence, responding freely to the perpetual media circuits of pleasure and terror, responding freely to the ongoing alarms of war, environmental catastrophe, global destruction, and global warming, demands a reorientation of feeling so that every new impulse is held at a distance until it fades or can be changed. While life beats its red rhythms and human swarms dance to the compulsion of strife, the interrupter learns how to die. Thank you. The question was asked about Buckminster Fuller's idea of sort of, and it's other people share it as well. It's a sort of, it's a more common idea, fantasy, desideratum of technology sort of becoming so ubiquitous and so refined and so light that it's basically integrated into our lives to the point where it's inseparable from us and not burdensome. And I think about that a lot. I live in Brooklyn and I have to commute to teach in Connecticut. And so I have to drive there because there's no good train. There's no train at all, actually, to where I have to go. And so I have to drive through these you know, interchanges, and there's just all this infrastructure. There's all these roads and trucks and tankers and just stuff, you know, and I don't see any solar panels. And I don't, you know, people have phones, and there's a great promise, especially in the immense leaps and bounds that have been made with digital technology and the internet and our phones and all this stuff. But, you know, it can only do so much, it seems. You know, like it seems like with the way we have the civilization structured, you know, running on fossil fuels anyway, the bricks and mortar, right, the pipes and the oil aren't going away. Now, you know, sure, I love this idea of shifting entirely to some sort of mixed renewable economy. I think it's a wonderful, wonderful idea. The thing that worries me about that is that I question, even if there was enough motivation and will and energy directed toward that, it would, you know, in best case scenario, it would still take 10 to 20 years to totally rebuild global energy infrastructure, and we're screwed by then anyway. So, all right, thanks. So the first question is, I guess, the global problem the best way to look at the problems that global climate change will pose to us? And maybe might it not be better to look at local possibilities? And the second question the writing process. How my writing process sort of contends with this or addresses these issues. So the first question, I think you're absolutely right. I mean, and that's part of my point is that the big problem is too big, and it's already, you know, there's already so much, we've already got so much warming, you know, toward catastrophic tipping points. There's already another like half a degree Celsius locked in because of the carbon just in the atmosphere now. And the odds of, you know, all the 200 some odd nations coming together and, you know, drafting a binding emissions reduction plan that's going to radically transform global energy infrastructure in the next decade are like zero, practically zero, right? We need to focus on, I think, precisely what you're talking about, like mitigation and adaptation at local levels and local and regional levels, building community networks, talking to each other, addressing those things, because you know, as we've seen here in the United States, just with Katrina, with Sandy, with other things, the state is not well prepared and not that interested in taking care of particularly, you know, less economically well-off communities, right? They're just going to let them go. And we need to prepare for that, not by gunning up, but by but by exactly what you're saying, like building local networks and confronting the issue as a question of how we're going to deal with it. The second question about the writing process, you know, it's a combination of, you know, I'm still doing some journalism things. In August, I went to the Arctic to look at what's happening there. And that piece will be coming out in The Nation later this month, about what some people are calling the Arctic death spiral, and coming to terms with the fact that you know, with by, you know, major respected polar scientists are expecting that we'll see ice-free summers in the Arctic by 2030, and that that's a major tipping point in terms of feedback loops. So looking at that, still looking at trying to do research and journalism on information itself, and also trying to think in a more philosophical way about some of the issues around the Anthropocene, conceptualizing human agency, and also, you know, trying to think about how, you know, race and the global South fits into this whole equation. You know, what's the connection? Is there a connection between Black Lives Matter and climate change? And, you know, how do we make sense of that? So those are a couple of the things I'm doing now. Yeah, so the question is about militancy and whether or not that's the only option. And, you know, you're right. If you look at the history, and I talk about this in the book, you know, even if you look at the labor movement, you look at even the civil rights movement, you know, there were a lot of guns involved. Say with civil rights, not just the National Guard that were brought down or the military that were brought down to protect marchers and to enforce federal legislation, but also weapons around Martin Luther King to protect him, and then other people as well earlier. And then, you know, of course, black radicalism offered by the Black Panthers and Malcolm X, that was an important factor in how things came out. Yeah, I mean, it's a difficult situation because the fact of the matter is that people who have power don't give it away, right? And that's not likely to happen. But there's two things I would say about that. I don't think the problem is that the left has lost its militancy. I think, I think the problem has more to do with not having leverage, right? The reason why unions and labor militancy could shut everything down is because, it's a sort of reductivist materialist argument, but because you could, coal miners can shut down an entire economy. And I don't know however many streets we could block, I don't know how we would shut down an entire economy today. They're just, the infrastructure is much better at rerouting, and it's also, the gasoline and oil, you can just move it around much more easily. The other thing is that, I struggled in thinking this through and writing it because I can't advocate violence as a political solution in this case, because violence brings more violence. Violence opens more violence. Violence is uncontrollable. Violence intensifies the situation. Violence makes things more extreme. And, you know, when it comes to a moment, you know, when people have to protect themselves or else, you know, I can't make a moral judgment about the decision they make. But where I'm at, I think where we're at here in this room, in this bookstore, whatever, it's hard for me to say that that now is the time for violence. I don't think I can do that. Question is there any living human society that has it right? And that's the thing, is that there's a problem with the way we live now and our government now and our energy systems now and all the carbon we've dumped into the atmosphere that's going to heat up the planet and make it unlivable. But there's also, like, there's also the problem that we're mortal, limited, finite, you know, primates who think we're way smarter than we are and who don't like thinking about the fact that we're going to die, you know? And that problem is never going to go away. That's always going to be a problem, is being human, right? And there's no solution for that. You can't Google it. Like, you can't outproduce it. You can't technologically fix it. It's just being human. We're mortal. We're limited. And, you know, I think there are societies in the past and some other societies still today that do a way better job of integrating that truth into daily life than we do in modern American consumer capitalism. But it's still a hard thing, and it's still, I think, you know, it's the fundamental thing we have to come to terms with, is our limitation of mortality as humans. Yeah. Would I recommend the samurai choice? Yeah, no, I mean, that's what I'm, I mean, it's learning to die in the Anthropocene. It's hospice. That's right. Yeah. Yeah, it's hospice for us individually and as a whole civilization. So the question is there any living human society that has it right? And that's the thing, is that there's a problem with the way we live now and our government now and our energy systems now and all the carbon we've dumped into the atmosphere that's going to heat up the planet and make it unlivable. But there's also, like, there's also the problem that we're mortal, limited, finite, you know, primates who think we're way smarter than we are and who don't like thinking about the fact that we're going to die. You know, and that problem is never going to go away. That's always going to be a problem, is being human, right? And there's no solution for that. You can't Google it. Like, you can't outproduce it. You can't technologically fix it. It's just being human. We're mortal. We're limited. And, you know, I think there are societies in the past and some other societies still today that do a way better job of integrating that truth into daily life than we do in modern American consumer capitalism. But it's still a hard thing, and it's still, I think, you know, it's the fundamental thing we have to come to terms with, is our limitation of mortality as humans. Would I recommend the samurai choice? Yeah, no, I mean, that's what I'm, I mean, it's learning to die in the Anthropocene. It's hospice. That's right. Yeah. Yeah, it's hospice for us individually and as a whole civilization.